didn't know we were going to be doing this today. We basically performed a professional furnace cleaning with Homeowner tools.
Okay, hey, Dad.
Hey, how are you?
Good. We're at our friend's house, and we realized, Dad, that you just keep mine so darn spick and span that it's not very interesting to show people sometimes. So my friends have not had their furnace or air conditioner maintained for the 5 years that they've lived here.
Right.
And they've also done a lot of home remodeling in the meantime. So mm-hmm. It might be interesting to open this sucker up and see what it looks like.
See what we find. So this is a 80% efficient furnace, and so it uses... its combustion air comes from inside this room. You can see that we're in kind of a dusty environment, so there's obviously a lot of dust inside this furnace mm-hmm. as well. I don't know if that picked that up.
Yep.
Yeah, let's go ahead and flip it off.
Okay.
So let's just take all the doors off the furnace and see what we got. So we're gonna clean this up as we go, but we're just looking right now.
Why would all that dust be a problem?
The dust somebody. We're going to show you, we're going to take the flame sensor out. Well, this is the flame sensor that comes out of the furnace. You know, we'd looked at yours before, mm-hmm. and yours was quite clean and shiny. Can you see all the residue that's on here? And see, it's been burned on. This goes right into the flame, and this actually used flame rectification. It puts a small current of electricity, goes from this rod through the flame to the ground of the furnace. And so that's how we prove whether we have established a flame or not. And what happens is this gets coated with this residue from the dust, all the dust that's going through here. It gets baked on and interferes with, causes resistance for that flame rectification signal to go through there. So you'll get nuisance lockouts and things like that when that doesn't get cleaned up. Flame is actually there, but it's not sensing that.
Okay, because it's too coated with all this stuff.
It's too dirty.
Okay.
This is the hot surface igniter. Do you see the difference here?
Yes.
With yours?
Yeah.
And see, these we really aren't gonna clean. This is really residue that's been burned on, mm-hmm. you know, to the surface. They can be very brittle and delicate here with them, so I'm really not going to mess with it too much. I don't want to cause a problem.
Right.
As you can see, we're showing some wear on the hot surface igniter there.
Okay.
Just wanted to show that to you. This is something just to kind of watch. You can see here's the filter. It's been changed mm-hmm. regularly. That's good. One thing you kind of want to watch for, though, see, this is it's a 20 by 24. And look what happens with our 20 by 24. Do you see how it's an inch short?
Yeah.
We really want this to be a 20 by 25 filter.
Uh-huh.
Though an inch sounds like it's pretty close.
But there's an inch of just unfiltered air.
Yes. Yeah. And as this filter loads up, it causes resistance to the air, and so more air is going to bypass around mm-hmm. it. So that's a lot of air that gets around it. I'm going to pull the blower out in here. Yeah. Okay. So this is. As you can see, everything is dusty.
Mm-hmm.
Well, just to show you, see, everything is dirty. And this really affects how much air the blower can move.
So that it's that dirty.
So that all definitely needs to be cleaned. However, this is something we typically take apart. And out in the yard, many times this can come off. You get a good cleaner on it. You can kind of see how everything is. Just dirty. And the thing is this is the duct system comes down through here. This is all this dirt is after the filter. And so there's obviously a lot of dust getting around the filter, but this all gets circulated right back through the system. So the dust comes through here, gathers on the blower wheel. It then gets blown up. I can tell you the bottom of this coil is going to look much like this, only the problem is that coil is typically wet. And so this dust, rather than being absolutely dry and flaky here, adheres to the wet coil that's mm-hmm. up above. So we can get into quite a mess with that. But so what I think I'm gonna do is just do a little vacuuming, just with a shop vac. We'll see what it looks like after that's done. I don't like how they've wired the humidifier, but that's my only option. It's I was just looking. Here they have wired the humidifier right here to the WNC, which is heating. So anytime there's a call for heat from the thermostat, it energizes the humidifier. But this is the most basic of furnaces. So here they've got a printed spot on the circuit board for a humidifier transformer where you could power it separately, so anytime it calls for the blower to operate, which is how I prefer doing it. And so what they're doing here, in the absence of the hookups for a separate transformer which comes with the humidifier and wires it independent of all the gas train controls, you know, right now what we're doing is we're using the little switch in the thermostat to turn the humidifier on, as well as complete the circuitry for the furnace as well. So I just like keeping it independent, but.
So why do you think that it was wired that way?
It was wired that way because it was the only way to get the humidifier to work on this particular furnace without either replacing this circuit board or putting a control on it that would sense when just the blower is on.
Okay.
Cost.
Yeah.
A little bit of cost is mm-hmm. the primary reason, and simplicity. But it's just a way of doing it that we don't see this problem as much as we used to, but the thermostat was not made to handle that load of water valves, as well as all the gas controls here.
Now what are you doing?
I'm cleaning the flame sensor off here.
Cleaning the flame sensor?
Yeah. I can feel it as I'm scraping it.
What are you looking for?
Just checking things.
Okay.
Now this is a little service window, so you can see the lights flashing on the circuit board inside the furnace. But can you see what's happened here?
See. So that's so you can see the lights on the circuit board. What would that indicate?
It's got a little heartbeat that you can see that it's got power to it. It will give a code, a flashing code, if it's got a problem. You know, and you can see that without disconnecting power to it.
Right. Okay.
And see, this is something that evidently the previous service guy did, and it's really not a good practice to be in. This is a door switch. I always explain this to my guys. This is actually a safety control. A lot of people don't think of it as a safety control. But what he's done is he's taped it on there, taped it down so it stays closed. So this furnace would operate with the door off of it. That's a very serious condition. If you were to operate this furnace with this blower door completely off, it's gonna draw flue gases. This blower down here is much stronger than any other any other movement of air around here, and so it's gonna draw flue gases into the condition space. So this is something you do not want to do. I'm sure he did it because he was servicing it and it was an easy way to run the furnace with the with your meters on it and things like that. I get that, but I just don't like seeing that, because I'm going to say it was accidental, but that's really, you accidentally bypassed a safety control, you know, and you really don't want to do that. I would advise against doing that. I've got a clip, get it from the hardware store, that actually you can clip on right here. So it'll make the switch. I can check my current draws on moat blowers and that sort of thing. But I can easily take it. The door is not going back on with that thing on there, with that clip on there. I'm gonna turn this furnace on now. Okay, so shown this before. First thing that comes on is the inducer assembly. It's going to come on. With a delay, the hot surface igniter is going to come on. It glows white hot in there. It looks like a little light. After a few seconds of establishing the hot surface igniter, the gas is going to turn on. So now we have current flow down through that flame rod that we cleaned into the flame back to ground, and it completes a circuit, so it knows that it's burning properly right now. We didn't have combustion. Say a spider built a little nest down there or something like that. We didn't have a flame right there. It would turn off the natural gas, you know, rather than being cooled. And then we're going to kind of preemptively say this. We're performing this tune-up with basic homeowner tools.
Yes, well, you are not prepared for a furnace maintenance, so don't make one of our tools today.
So now we're waiting for the main blower to come on.
Dad, you were just telling me if I've ever seen these fault codes on the back of the furnace door, and I have not. So what do these mean here?
Well, they're pretty indescript here. You really kind of have to read the fine print. You have a set of fault codes for this particular furnace, and there is a window in the blower door. You can view, with the door in place, you can view codes. And this has a little light down here, this little orange light in the corner. You can see that it's on. And it will change depending on the modes that it's in, if it's sensing a problem or something like that. So this is one of the things you can do. Don't touch anything, don't turn anything on, don't turn anything off. First thing, go and see if you can see any codes that are in there. Because as soon as you turn the power on or off, you're gonna reset that code.
You know? So just as it is not functioning, go and look in the little window and see if you can see any codes blinking.
Yeah. But those codes are listed here. Every furnace has them. They may be in a different place, but look for a fault code list, and it'll give you an index as far as whatever kind of sequence of blinks, or every furnace is a little bit different, but the furnace will help you tell you what's going on. And then that is all reset when you turn the power off to the furnace. So you can simply recycle the furnace by turning the power off and back on again. simply taking that door off and letting it kill the power here, or going over here and shutting it off. Wait 2 or 3 minutes, turn it back on, and it will at least try and refire. Recycle. And you can watch it now to see what's going on with it. The heat's back on, and understand we didn't know we were going to be doing this today. We basically performed a professional furnace cleaning with Homeowner tools. So, no, it's in good shape. But we do typically have more specialty tools, especially for the vacuum, and how I clean the blower wheel isn't really the standard way.
Right. So what would you, if you were talking to the homeowner, what would you recommend be done further on, you know?
Well, it still needs to be cleaned. The blower needs to be cleaned. And with the homeowner's permission, I would take it all apart and take it out in the yard and clean it. you know, the wheel needs to be cleaned, which means the whole blower assembly needs to be cleaned.
Okay.
And with it out, you know, now you're washing it with, you know, a hard spray of water and good detergents, and, you know, it comes out really easy.
Yeah.
You know, the dirt comes off really easy. But where I was trying to brush it with a brush, and it's kind of stuck on, you know, so. But it literally melts once you get good pressure, stream of water on it with soap.
Okay. But other than that, you check the humidifier.
So we've got the humidifier going. It was turned up, the water was turned off on it. And so it's working now. It's got a cheap aftermarket pad, but it's late in the season while we're doing this, so it'll be fine for the rest of the season.
Okay.
Thermostat satisfied. That's it.
Thanks, Dan.
Yeah.
All right.